There are people who have logged in at both places, on Zoom as well as on YouTube. So they're writing a message there as soon as we are speaking here.
Hi, hello everyone who is joining us on YouTube. We have a lot of people who are on the live chat. Thank you all for joining us. And
hello everyone who's joining us on YouTube.
So those of you on YouTube who have questions, you know, please try and do it on live chat. I would request we keep the live chat for questions, and we don't type in, wishes and greetings, because it'll become difficult for us to sort through the stream for questions. But a very good evening to every one of you. All right, we can formally start now.
Yes.
Reverend Father Ignacimuthu, Reverend Father Tomasin, Reverend Father Narendra Singh, Mrs. Karuna Singh, Colonel Vijay Bhaskar, Rishabh, Anupam, Vivek, all the friends who have joined in on behalf of ALSOC, it's my pleasure and privilege to welcome all of you to this very special seminar on care for our common home. We have a very interesting and knowledgeable host of panelists for you this evening. And I will not take up any further time. My name is Siddhant Kaul, and I am the Honorary Secretary of the Old Boys Association. We are helping the school and the province in organizing this webinar. But for now, without any further ado, may I welcome Reverend Father Tomasin, who is the principal of St. Xavier's Collegiate School, the president of Alumnorum Societas, and also the head of the Ecology Commission of the Calcutta Jesuit province, to kindly deliver his welcome address.
Reverend Father Raphael Joseph Hyde, the provincial of Calcutta Jesuit province, Reverend Father Jayaraj Veluswamy, the rector of St. Xavier's, Kolkata, Reverend Father Dr. Dominic Savio, principal of St. Xavier's College, Kolkata, Reverend Father Dr. S. Ignacimuthu, former principal of Loyola College, Chennai, and former vice chancellor of Madras and Coimbatore universities, respected vice principals of St. Xavier's Collegiate School, Kolkata, Mr. Siddhant Kaul, the honorary secretary of Alumnorum Societies, our esteemed panelists, Mr. Vijay Bhaskar, Ms. Karuna Singh, respected principals of all our Jesuit schools and colleges, professors, teachers, members of ALSOC, members of St. Xavier's College alumni, parents, and well-wishers, a very good evening to all of you. On behalf of the Ecology Commission of Calcutta Jesuit Province and the administration, staff, and students of St. Xavier's College, Collegiate School, and ALSOC, I welcome you all to this webinar. This webinar, Care of Our Common Home, is presented to us with a detailed discussion on ecological conditions affecting us, and particularly the vulnerable poor of our society. Therefore, care of our common home is certainly the need of the hour. The most important and primary duties of humankind is, as always be, to be caring and preserving our common home. In recent times, it is noticed that we have forgotten and forsaken our common home because of our consumerist attitudes. Analysis of our common home shows that there are 7 degradations of creations. These degradations, all of which we interact, include alteration of Earth's energy exchange with the sun that results in global warming and destruction of the Earth's protection ozone shield. Land degradation that destroys land erosion, salinization, and desertification, and reduces available land for creatures and crops. Deforestation that annually removes over 1 lakh square kilometers of primary forest and degrades all equal amount by overuse. Spacious extension that finds more than 3 species of plants and animals eliminated from the earth each day. Water quality degradation that defiles groundwater, lakes, rivers, and oceans. Waste generation and global toxification that results from atmospheric and oceanic circulation of materials people inject into the air and water. Human and cultural degradation that threatens and eliminates long-standing human communities that have lived sustainably with creation, eliminate a multitude of long-standing varieties of food and garden plants. My dear friends, remember, we have only one planet Earth. Its capacity to support a thriving diversity of species, humans included, is limited. There is an erosion of the health of the Earth's living system. A recent survey on the state of the Earth today reveals that the year 2019 is considered to be one of the top 5 hottest years ever recorded. About 12 billion tons of ice melted off Greenland's ice sheet in a single day in the month of August 2019. About 2.5 acres of land burned due to wildfires in California in the year 2019. 10,000 square kilometers of land in Brazil's Amazon rainforest cleared due to deforestation between January and August 2019. 1 million land and marine species have become extinct due to human actions. 11,000 scientists from 153 countries who declared a climate emergency in the month of November 2019, warning that untold human suffering is unavoidable without drastic action. Things have gone from bad to worse in most part of the world today. Our late Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was known as a champion of ecological conservation, stated that one cannot be truly human and civilized unless one looks upon not only all fellow men, but creation with the eyes of a friend. Our common home today is crying out as never before, laboring to be set free. Today's environmental crisis has an impact in a particular way on the poor and vulnerable. Action is needed urgently by all of us to become honest custodians of this wonderful planet. We are called to go through a series of processes of ecological conversion. To mention a few, we need to know ourselves that we are of the earth unearthly. We need to know ourselves that one is in constant relationship with the other living species. to become aware of the imbalances that one creates knowingly or unknowingly to the environment, to collaborate in the sustainable development of ecology. My dear friends, I'm sure that this webinar will inspire us to collaborate globally and locally with our Mother Earth for our harmony and sustainable development. May God bless all of us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Reverend Father, for that opening message. May I now request one of our youngest panelists to also welcome all the attendees using the power of his voice and the power of song. This will be the welcome message on behalf of the students of St. Xavier's. Rishabh, can you please unmute yourself and go ahead? Thank you.
Muted.
Which is sung and composed by Michael Jackson.
Oh.
Shall I start?
Yeah.
Flowering fields, is there a time
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Rishabh, for that wonderful song and message. It's really appreciated and enjoyed by all of us attending. Thank you so much. That was beautiful. I would now like to share with you, all the participants, a message that our Father Provincial, Reverend Father Raphael Hyde, has recorded for us. He unfortunately was at the last minute pulled away into another commitment that was unavoidable, but he spent time to share his message with us, which I will now I will now share.
Vice Chancellor of Coimbatore and Madras Universities, respected Vijay Bhaskar, Managing Director, Hamara Great Private Limited, respected Ms. Karuna Singh, Regional Director, South Asia and Country Director, India, Earth Day Network, the organizing teams of this webinar, Reverend Father Dr. M. Thamaseen Arulappan, S.J., Principal of St. Xavier's Collegiate School, Vice Principals of St. Xavier's Collegiate School, Honorary Secretary of ALSOC and members of ALSOC, and all our well wishers, a very good evening to you all. I am happy to know that the Ecology Commission of the Calcutta Jesuit Province is in association with St. Xavier's Collegiate School and ALSOC is organizing this webinar to help us understand the pains and agonies of our common home and our responsibility to act locally and globally in the protection and preservation of our environment. The earth provides enough to satisfy every man's need, but not every man's greed. Production of sustainable development as a global issue in recent times. Pope Francis's recent encyclical, Laudato Si, has the subtitle on care of our common home. In it, the Pope critiques consumerism and irresponsible development, laments environmental degradation and global warming, and calls all people of the world to take swift and unified global action. Never have we so hurt and mistreated our common home as we have in the last 200 years. The problems are big and urgent. The Society of Jesus is commissioned with a mission of protecting the planet and our vulnerable people and of promoting the sustainable development of our environment. Reverend Father Arturo Sosa, the Superior General of the Society of Jesus, on 19 February 2019 in Rome, promulgated four universal apostolic references as emerged as urgent needs of today. They are to show the way to God through the spiritual exercises and discernment, to walk with the poor, the outcasts of the world, those whose dignity has been violated in a mission of reconciliation and justice, to accompany young people in the creation of a hope-filled future, to collaborate in the care of our common home. He then asked the Jesuits and the partners in mission to focus on how our current and future ministries can integrate the four universal apostolic preferences to address the real world issues that they embrace. In the encyclical Laudato Si, Pope Francis reminds us that all human beings share responsibility for care of creation, considered by many people as Mother Earth. This Mother Earth now cries out to us because of the harm we have inflicted on her by our irresponsible use and abuse of the goods with which God has endowed on her. The damage done to the earth is also damage done to the most vulnerable, such as the indigenous peoples, peasants forced to immigrate, and the inhabitants of urban peripheries. The environmental destruction being caused by the dominant economic systems is inflicting intergenerational damage. Not only does it affect those now living on earth, particularly the very young, but it also conditions and jeopardizes the life of future generations. We resolve, considering who we are and the means that we have, to collaborate with others in the construction of alternative models of life that are based on respect for creation and on a sustainable development capable of producing goods that, when justly distributed, ensures a decent life for all human beings on our planet. The Ecology Commission of Calcutta Jesuit Province has already undertaken some areas of work, namely, about 400 saplings are planted in Jesuit-run institutions and other places. A herbal garden is set up to preserve the traditional knowledge of the medicinal plants and their uses. Webinars are arranged throughout the year to address various issues related to the environment. More needs to be done. It will be possible only with your cooperation and selfless service in our missions. I wish to congratulate the team on their relentless service in educating us to make our little contributions towards the protection of our Mother Earth. I would like to wish the principals, vice principals, teachers, students, old boys, associations, parents in all our institutions for attending this webinar. My sincere thanks to all the panelists, Reverend Father Inasimuttu S.J., Mr. Vijay Bhaskar, and Ms. Karuna Singh, for accepting our invitation to enlighten us on the various themes of ecology. Once again, I wish to applaud the sincere efforts made by each of you for this webinar, despite the challenges we face due to the pandemic situation. May God bless all of you.
Thank you to Reverend Father Raphael Hyde for sharing his special message with us. May I request Father Ignisimuthu to take this theme forward and explain to us how the Jesuit traditions and teachings and practices are intertwined with the ecology, and what is the contribution of especially Jesuit education to this field. Reverend Father, over to you. Reverend Father, I think you're on mute. We can't hear you.
Thank you for this beautiful opportunity to share with you some ideas related to what Jesuits have been doing in the field of environment, the contribution that we have made in ecology, past few years. As it has already been beautifully explained, we are part of environment, and everything that we do touches on the environment, and therefore all of us need to have responsibility to protect and conserve our environment. In that way, we have to play an important role. So now I will share with you a few of the ideas that our Jesuit fathers have been doing in the past on various areas related to ecology and environment, and how we have contributed to some extent to the protection and conservation of environment.
Father, the screen share has stopped.
Commitment to ecology represents an integral part of the Jesuit way of proceeding. We all are aware that Jesuits have a special, you know, charism or a dynamism to get into any area that is important and also demanding. And recently, our own Jesuit congregation has taken up environment as one of the important issues. So this is an integral part of our way of life. Ignatian spirituality itself prompts us to find God in all things and all things in God. This is what is motivating us also to love nature, to love creation, and also to do everything to safeguard. Ignatius himself witnessed how God was acting in the world. He used to look at the stars and get, you know, inspiration. And the world itself, he was able to, you know, visualize and see how we can contribute to for the betterment of the world. So all these have been part of Jesuit involvement in the relation to environment. And Jesuits also seek the active and immanent presence of God in environment. We all believe God is manifesting himself through environment. Beautiful song of the bird, the nice colors of the flowers, the green grass, the blue sky, the shining stars, all of them are inviting us to recognize God's presence, and that way to respond ourselves to environmental call. Now, I will just give you some of the areas in which our Jesuits have been involved. They have really done some work related to various facets of environment. One important area, of course, has been biodiversity, the study and also enumeration and conservation of various important plants and animals and so on. So biodiversity, as you know, is very, very important because they are the ones that contribute to the life of people. The genes they contain offer so many possibilities for future generations, and we all have our food only because of the diversity that we have on Earth. So biodiversity is an area where we have concentrated quite a lot. Environmental awareness is another area where our own Jesuits have involved themselves quite a bit in many, many parts of India. Then we have also worked on giving some alternate energy sources because of the fuel consumption and the negative effects of fuel use and so on. So solar energy and the other types of energy, alternate energy sources have also been promoted. Watershed programs have been promoted in very big way in many, many provinces by our Jesuits because they wanted to help the farmers, particularly those in poorer areas, to store water and make use of it. And then later on, some places where waste treatment, both solid and liquid waste management, some of our Jesuit fathers have been involved and they have given good input in all this. Organic farming is one area where we have also concentrated quite a bit. Now it is picking up in different places because people have realized that having safe and good and healthy food requires avoiding pesticides, chemical pesticides and chemical fertilizers. So organic farming and sustainable agriculture is one area. Another area is herbal drugs, where we try to already available medicinal plants are made use of to find, discover newer ways, newer drugs and so on. And we have also promoted herbal pesticides, natural pesticides, instead of synthetic chemical pesticides to control insect pests. Important area has been eco-spirituality, for which our own Pope himself is a big, big example, where we have promoted God's presence in nature, in the creation, and therefore our response to these also should be related. The foremost person related to eco-spirituality is Pope Francis. You know, through his encyclical Laudato Si, which he released in 2015, Praise Be to You, that is the meaning of Laudato Si, Praise Be to You, that is to God. He invites all people of the world to protect our common home, that is the planet Earth. We all live together. We live in this planet Earth. And unless we are able to protect it, the future generations are going to suffer. And he enumerates so many important issues related to what is going on today in the environment to really give harm to the common home. And then what we can do to overcome, like, you know, reducing our needs, avoiding consumerism, overcoming selfishness. There are a lot of beautiful things our Pope has given. In fact, this was one of the important contributions he made through the church, where the government, as well as the world body, the United Nations and all others, took it up for their own discussion, and they came out with different protocols to safeguard Mother Earth. He is calling every one of us to care for creation. His call is not only for Christians, but all people of goodwill. Everyone who is interested to have a good life in this world, he is also advocating eco-spirituality, by which he says, let us feel the presence of God in our midst, in everything that God has created. And through that, let us raise ourselves to God and protect our environment. Some others, like, you know, Father Jerry Rosario, Vincent Braganza, Vincent Sega, Robert Atikal, then Lancy De Cruz, Rapai, and myself, we have promoted also environmental spirituality through writings and through talks and so on. Here, for example, I'll give you one of my own books, Environment Spirituality, which was published by St. Paul Publications, very well received all over in the world. Then Religions, Ecology and Environment has been brought out by Vincent Sega. This is a book where it combines all the sayings related to ecology and environment from world religions, different religions. And the latest book which I have also brought out is Praying with Creation, that let us make prayer itself offered to God, which is meaningful enough to motivate us to become agents of environmental protection. So this is one area where Jesuits have contributed. The second area I already mentioned is biodiversity. Biodiversity, we all know, is the variety of living things that is on this earth. Many of our Jesuits from different parts of India were involved in preserving biodiversity. Noted among them are Father Blatter, Cayuse, Santapo. These three were very well known in Mumbai, St. Xavier's College, for their contribution. Father Cecil Saldana, he was in Karnataka, and he has done a lot of work in enumerating and documenting the biodiversity of flowering plants and so on. Father K. Matthew, V.S. Manikam, John Brito, and myself, we have also done quite a lot of work and diversified studies in relation to plants, flowering plants, and non-flowering plants like ferns, and also insects, the flora and fauna. Father Santapo was the director of Botanical Survey of India, very rare honor for a Jesuit to be given the important position of a Botanical Survey of India director. So he was well known for his contribution, and I think he was also awarded Padma Shri, if I am not mistaken. Then some of the books on the flora, as you can see, many of these were brought out by our own Jesuits, all of them based on the field study they have undertaken and documented them. And for the public, they have brought out this flora as a living monument for people. Then other books on some flora and fauna. The latest book is on the moths of Tamil Nadu, which we have recently brought out. These are insects which are also, very some of them are harmful, some are beneficial, but knowing them and identifying them is important for taking care of our environment. So this is one area where our Jesuits have contributed. Another important area is environmental awareness. Many of us are involved in promoting environmental awareness among students, farmers, public, and so on. Noted among them are Father K. Matthew, John Brutto, myself, Robert Athikil through Tharum Mitra, Rapai through his own endeavors of local Tharum Mitra, Gujarat Tharum Mitra, Lansiri Cruz from Gujarat, S. Kennedy from Madurai province. So these are some Jesuits who have been involved in environmental awareness and then motivating especially the students and the farmers and the public to love environment and contribute something to preserve our environment. Father K. Matthew was confirmed Indira Gandhi Paryavaran Puraskar Award in 2004 from Government of India for his meritorious contribution to environmental protection. This was the highest award that could be obtained, and for his great contribution in creating environmental awareness, he was given this award. And myself got three different awards from Government of Tamil Nadu, one for a book on environmental awareness and two for environmental management. The Tharum Mitra, as you all know, has many branches all over India to promote environmental awareness and protection. So these are some of the efforts that our own Jesuits have taken in the field of environmental awareness. These are some of the books that we have also brought out in relation to environment, which contributes also for our creation of knowledge as well as people's study, so that students can get more knowledge through what we are writing. And this is our, some of these input related to us. Now, coming to alternate energy, many Jesuits have worked in this area. Alternate energy, I mean, instead of depending only on fossil fuels for our energy resource, we can our electricity obtained from some of the sources which are, you know, contributing. We can go in for solar energy. And one of the important persons long ago was one Father Sao Bole. He was a pioneer in the use of gobar gas plant and solar power. He built many prototype instruments for, you know, like solar cooker and solar dryer and things like that. Then Father Chenakala and Mile and M.M. Matthew, he is known as Solar Matthew from Patna province and now also in Gujarat and so on. They have promoted the use of gobar gas and solar plants all over India, particularly in many of the institutions which are run by us. Here, some small examples to show how some of these are working. Now, coming to watershed programs. Watershed program is one area where we are able to help, particularly the rural poor, the farmers, those who are depending on rain for cultivation of their crops. So we help them to harvest rain and water and then replenish the groundwater and at the same time store them. And many of them have worked in this area and helped many barren villages to become green. In here, for example, Chenakala, Saju Bastin, Tigga, Bakker, Joseph have played a great role in promoting watershed programs in many parts of North India and have helped many rural farmers to reap great benefits. One of our Jesuit brother, Cicerone, helped the collector of Madurai, Tamil Nadu, to create the beautiful lake at Kodaikanal. He was the one who gave the idea how the place can be bonded and a lake can be created. So these are some of the contributions that we have been involved in. Now, greening of villages, already, you know, our provincial mentioned and also Tamisin mentioned that a lot of saplings are being planted in different parts. Therefore, there are many, many villages throughout India where Jesuits are involved, Jesuit institutions are involved. They have made them fertile through watershed programs, and they have also planted trees abundantly in many places to make them green. And some of the places which were dry earlier have become green villages because of the intervention by our Jesuits. organic farming is one area which is catching up today with lots of demand for organic products, and many Jesuit institutions are promoting organic farming and sustainable agriculture. Students are given training. Farmers are also given awareness and training. They are trained to take up organic farming. We ourselves are just now running a project with our farmers here in this part of Tirunelveli district, where the farmers are encouraged to take up organic farming and sustainable agriculture. And quite a few books have been written, pamphlets have been distributed to encourage them to take up organic farming. And here are some photographs to say how our students and the research staff go and interact with people and help them to understand and try to practice. And when we compose organic fertilizers, we teach them how they can be prepared, naturally used, and therefore hands-on training is also given by our people. Herbal drugs is one area, you know, we are all very aware that instead of allopathic medicine, it is always better to go for herbal drugs, which are healthy and which have been traditionally used for many, many years without any kind of negative effects. And therefore, we are also working, not only we, but there are many other people also who have been working in this area among Jesuits from all over India. One Father Constantine Besky, already, you know, in 1720s, he had documented 17 volumes of herbal medicine used in Tamil Nadu by various practitioners. It's called Siddha medicine. And even today, some of them, which are mentioned in his book, are used by other Siddha practitioners to distribute for people. And myself, John Brito, Melu Kunnel, Lancy De Cruz, we have scientifically, and also Vincent Braganza, they have scientifically validated many of the herbal drugs used to treat various ailments. And we have also published many, many papers related to this, so that scientifically, what our practitioners, particularly herbal practitioners, are doing, we are validating them and giving them real validity at the international level. Some of these examples here, we have prepared some of these, which are also now distributed. Particularly during this time of corona, we prepared a Xavier sanitizer, which became very, very prominent in this part of India. Then we also had a floor cleaner. Then we prepared a small tablets, herbal medicine for even COVID-19. We have sent it to ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research, for testing and then giving us the feedback related to how efficacious it is to control. Then herbal pesticide is one area which is today talked about quite a bit because of environmental protection. We want to protect the environment from extensive use of chemical pesticides. Myself and my team of scientists and students, after many years of useful work, we have produced quite a few varieties of different types of herbal pesticides which control insect pests, including mosquitoes. Some of them are already manufactured by companies and they are marketed. And one example is Ponni. And a lot of farmers have appreciated this. And
excuse me, Father.
Yeah.
Your screen sharing went off some time ago. I don't know if you had it on or you were just speaking.
No, I am. Screen is on. How is it?
Father, the share screen button, I think you may have switched it off inadvertently. So we can hear you, see you fine. But your presentation, your presentation is not visible.
I'm sorry. I will just rework at it. It's a very nice screenshots people have missed. Can you see now?
Yes, Father. Now we can see.
Now just, the screen can be seen. No. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'll just run through very fast, very, very simple.
Father, yeah. Just put it on. Now we can see it fully. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So here is one area where we have in the eco-spirituality, Pope Francis was the main one, and following him, many other fathers in India have contributed. Some of them through books, through retreat and so on. You can see here screen. And then biodiversity, many fathers from the Xavier's Mumbai, then Joseph's from Bangalore, and Father Matthew from Trichinopoly, Father Manikam from St. Javier's, Palayamkottai, Father John Brito, and myself. We have also brought out many books. Father Santappa was the first director of Botanical Survey of India, which I already mentioned. These are some of the books of our Jesuits, which are used as textbooks all over the country. This recent book, latest book on moths of Tamil Nadu, related to insect fauna. And then environmental awareness, many works have been done. Father Matthew was one of the foremost in this, and he received Indian government's award. And myself got 3 awards from Tamil Nadu government. Then these are some of the books related to our work related to environment. These are all used as textbooks, reference books in all libraries in India. Then alternate energy, I already mentioned, using some solar panel and solar cooker. And then watershed programs have been very helpful for the rural poor, where they have been able to develop well. Organic farming is one area where we have done good work, a lot of reach out to the farmers, and we help them using vermicompost, organic fertilizer, and so on. Then herbal drugs, as I said, have been prepared, and we have also studied and published many papers related to this herbal medicine. Is related to even COVID. We had a sanitizer, we have COVID medicine, which is now being tested by ICMR, and then some other natural products which are useful. Then coming to herbal pesticide, this is the last slide I was in when you intervened. So ponneem is a natural pesticide which is used by farmers all over India and even abroad in controlling insect pests, natural product. It is obtained from different natural compounds from neem and pungemia and a few other combinations. Then we have also developed many herbal mosquito products which are already handed over to some of the companies to promote. All of them herbal, and therefore some of the coverage related to our work, particularly natural pesticide, appeared in natural dailies as well as newspapers and journals. Then one of the important area of work is replanting our materials, particularly many plants which are endangered. We do a lot of work in tissue culture in the laboratory, raise them in cows and sons, and then replant them in natural environment. This through tissue culture. So many of our fathers, particularly Leo D'Souza from Mangalore, Aloysius College, Vincent Braganza from Gujarat, Ahmedabad, St. Javier's, myself, we have done quite a lot of work and replanted many acres of land in forest using our tissue culture technique. This is one of the slides to show how we raise the plants in the laboratory. And then many more Jesuits. I have only mentioned here a few names, but many more Jesuits and many Jesuit institutions have been involved in many of the environmental activities. More than 100 books and 300 research articles related to ecology have been written by Jesuits. All their names could not be mentioned here due to time constraint. Many have also inspired other voluntary organizations to work for environmental protection. So in short, motivated by Ignatian spirituality, Jesuits have involved themselves to take care of environment. Pope Francis himself, a Jesuit, has taken the lead to motivate all people of goodwill to protect the environment. Many Jesuits got involved in various activities related to environment. Hopefully, this trend will continue in future as well. In short, environment is no one's property to destroy. It is everyone's responsibility to protect. Thank you. All the best. God bless you.
Thank you. Thank you, Reverend Father, for that very stirring message, and which has highlighted in great detail the contributions of the Jesuits. And it's very heartwarming to see, even research is being carried out, spirituality is being encouraged, and literature is being done. So we are touching every aspect of spreading awareness and doing the actual work, both of them.
Thank you.
With that thought, I think it's the perfect getaway into the next segment of our talk. Someone who is actually doing a lot of work in the field, that is environmentally responsible and also very much attuned to the needs of the less fortunate brethren. May I invite Colonel Vijay Bhaskar, Managing Director of Hamara Grid, to kindly give us his special address.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Siddhant, and thank you, Father Thomason, Father Raphael, and Father Ignatius Mutu for setting the stage. And it's very, really humbling to see the huge amount of work that the justice organizations have done, and you yourself as a person. And I think what we now move to the ground where a lot of these stuff we're trying to emulate on the ground. And so the work started in 2011 when I was given a mandate by a French couple who founded a small organization called the Melinda Foundation. And they gave me a mandate to work in the Sundarban jungles on the Tiger Reserve, on the fringes of the Tiger Reserve, and try and find a way to reserve, to reverse environmental degradation. Now, I was from the army. The background was from the army, 25 years. And I didn't know the local language as well. So I had a very able person, a deputy, worked with me, Mr. Suresh Namukherjee. And the two of us spent almost 2 years, from 2011 to 2013, on the buffer zone and in the adjoining islands in Patar Pratima and Kultori blocks of the Sundarbans, of South 24 Parvana. Now, we tried to understand what's happening over there and try and see what is it, why it was that the biodiversity, the marine diversity, and a lot of other things are being destroyed. And what could be the reasons for that, and what can be done to permanently reverse this kind of thing. So over a period of time, we lived and worked with them and tried to understand this. We found that it was poverty that was really driving them. If you look at them as a lot, the carbon footprint is extremely, extremely low. I think the carbon footprint is even less than 1.5 tons per annum for human beings. And whereas if you look at the United States of America, it's something like 26 tons. So they're 1/26 of all the developed world is doing. But the theory here, I mean, the hypothesis here was to try and develop a low carbon model which could be emulated the world over. And so there was a series of projects that we were trying to execute over a period of time, which included things from waste to energy projects to different better cooking techniques, to converting the local diesel rickshaws to electric vehicles, to biofuels, and etc. One of the projects that really took off was electric vehicles project, and these islands are very large islands in the Sundarbans, and they're almost 100 square kilometers each, and there's they're all interconnected by water, inland water transport, and there are jetties which are connected by thin brick roads that go from one end to the other, and they use the very a jugaad kind of a vehicle, a cargo carrier from a human transport vehicle, which they called a diesel van, which really is a very, very minimalistic kind of a rickshaw, which is powered by anything, a pump set engine or a Chinese, second-hand engine, and which used to use a fuel called solvent. It is a local term for adulterated fuel, which was diesel mixed with engine oil with a whole lot of other ingredients. Extremely cheap, would make the engine run, but very, very polluting. There was a whole lot of other things that were going on over there, which was mainly related to poverty, and there's a lot of middlemen who were exploiting them. So among the series of projects that we started implementing over there, the one which really took off was the electric vehicles project. And there was this company called Reva, electric car company from Bangalore, who now acquired by a very large automotive firm and is now Mahindra Reva. And they had a very very visionary CTO at that point, who helped me to design a rickshaw that could an electric vehicle that would replace the diesel rickshaw there. And we got all the blocks in the Sundarbans, almost 32 of them, to write down the communities, worked with them in order for them to agree to shift from this mode of transport to a very clean mode of transport. When we started really implementing them and placed a very large order, we had to build a number of electric charging stations en route on those islands in order to charge these vehicles, because there's no electric grid on those islands at that point. We're talking about 2012 or so. Now, when Mahindra acquired Reva, then there was a problem because the vehicle which we had designed sort of, was in competition with another vehicle, a diesel vehicle on the market called Jio. So they would not go ahead with this project, and we were left with a whole load of electric charging stations on the island, on top of school tops and rooftops in bazaars and so on. So the locals came to us and said that, can you give us electricity from these charging stations? And we tried to do that, and these villages are very, very large in the Sundarbans. There are a lot of inter-house distances, and we found that with a single charging station, we could not power an entire village. And then we started designing very small ecosystems that would provide 5 hours of electricity to about 10 to 15 houses at a time. This project was financed by our APEX Rural Bank, NABARD. And then a very innovative financing mechanism came into being, and this concept spread all over these islands. And this was extremely popular because there was no electricity on these islands, and they were getting about 7 hours, 6 hours of electricity, 5 hours in the evening and 1 hour in the morning. And they would charge their mobile phones, and they were in communication with the rest of the world. Now, this started spreading to other islands, and the government came to us and said, can you move this also to a place called Purulia? There's a place called Ayodhya Hills in Purulia, which is an extremely remote place. And at that point, it was being used by left-wing extremists as a transit kind of area to move from Jharkhand towards the northeast. So it was an extremely difficult area for the government to penetrate. And we could do it just like the Jesuit priests have gone everywhere. We could go there because we were basically working for these communities. And we, from 2013 to 2015, we electrified 36 villages based on this concept. And a large number of other bazaars and small machinery started getting powered by these. The Jharkhand government then came to us and said, can you help us move it? Because we also have this left-wing extremist problem in bordering districts. And from there, we moved to the districts of Simdega, East Singhmun, and Gumla in Jharkhand. I'm very, very happy to share, coincidentally, that there was this organization, the Management Board of St. Ignatius School in Gumla, and an organization called Arouse, which really helped us to get connected with these communities in these three districts. And we began working in very remote villages and providing and electrified almost 310 villages there. Now, once we started working with these communities, they came back to us and said that it's fine, our quality of life has changed. We have electricity for 5-6 hours. Our children can study, our women can work, cook late in the evening. But what we really want is for our livelihoods to change. We want to have electricity that can power agricultural machinery and irrigation pumps for us. And then we sat down and designed a system by which we could do this. That means 24/7 electricity in very remote tribal villages that could power anything from domestic consumption to heavy machinery. And then we started work in two very remote villages called Naradoli and Shaitoli in Gumla. This was in 2015-2016. And we worked out and we found that though we had money from grants and stuff like that, we knew that to make a model scalable and replicable and it has to be a commercially viable model. We got some money from the government and from some institutions to CSR for the initial couple of projects. And we built these as an example and showed it to the other villages around. Now these villages, systems with about 20-25 kilowatts each. They had battery banks to operate at night. There was a system of quick startup to manage peak loads. And then we could provide them 24/7 electricity, and we could power all the machines in the village. We converted all the machines from diesel to electric, kerosene to electric, and then started powering them initially. But many of these villages are so poor, so unexposed to the business world. And many of the hot village markets that happen every week, the system is still barter. And for them to understand a business model and start being able to market things and earn a living was extremely difficult. and also the paying ability, the purchasing power, the ability to pay was also limited. And we found that in order for these villages to grow, they had to take their produce to markets outside, preferably urban markets. So the involvement began getting deeper and deeper. And also from just purely powering irrigation pumps and agri-processing machinery such as atta chakis, dhan kootne wala and rice dehusking plants, oil expellers, cold stores, grain pulverizers, and such like machines, we started moving into the realm of other businesses such as welding machinery, metal fabrication plants, carpentry, foundry, and so on. Normal things that would be there in any village. And where it did not exist in the tribal villages, they exposed them to other villages which had these things and started getting them to building the capacities. So we found that even with all this, the market linkage was still a problem because they could not sell. They were really shy of going and selling things in market, especially the women. So we started working with them on the entire value chain from agriculture productivity, as what Nishimuthu was trying to tell us, from the seeds, quality of seeds, to what kind of irrigation is to be done, to nutrition, micronutrition, to organic pesticide, and then the logistics of harvesting, and how do you do quality control there, bagging, drying, and then actually doing the agricultural processing and branding their products in order and marketing them in urban markets. So these products started being sold in markets as far as Gurgaon, Kolkata, Ranchi, and so on. And some of the departmental chains started buying these goods. So it's been a success story so far. There were 45 villages that we worked on and completely transformed them. I'm very happy to share with you that for the last 4 years, year on year, there's been an increase in personal incomes of over 25% year on year. So that's a very, very huge amount. And we hope that what we've been talking about for so many years, that we're going to double the farm income, double the rural incomes, is something that's actually happening on the ground. So we are very happy to share with you that we received a huge amount of interest in remote villages in UP, Bihar, and some very, very deep down districts, such as Bahraich, Gonda, and in Bihar as well as Muzaffarpur, etc. And in central Myanmar, a large number of villages which needed this model. We started work there, and this model is spreading fairly fast, and there's a lot of help coming from other agencies such as the governments, World Bank, and a number of other multilateral institutions. So Africa is another prime area where it's happening, where energy access is extremely poor, and we will be working in Ethiopia and Nigeria to start with, and then on to Sierra Leone and Senegal. Now, it's not as very big compared to what Jasita organizations are doing, but in a very humble way, we created a low carbon economy model that is capable of being scaled. That's it from my side. Thank you very much for this opportunity to present to such an august audience. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Colonel Bhaskar. It's very heartening to hear of the success that you've had and the kind of work that you're doing. And I think all of us will take your message home and try and see if we can also do something for these sections of the country that are very often ignored by a lot of other efforts. Now, can I request Mrs. Karuna Singh to please address us? Mrs. Singh, as we mentioned earlier, is the director for Asia on the Earth Day Network, which has been associated with the ecological movement for over 50 years. They have also worked very closely with the Vatican and in developing the mission of taking the message to the entire world. And she's going to address us on how we can improve our climate literacy and how we can spread this idea of a common home from one generation to the next.
Thank you so much, Siddhant. It's a pleasure being here. And I'm really honored to be at an event that St. Xavier's is organizing. I owe you all deep gratitude because my late husband, my two sons, and my son-in-law are all products of St. Xavier's. And I have seen in them the great spirit of Nihil Ultra. And I have seen the strong foundation they have where they believe in themselves, because what they have learned very thoroughly. They have know that they can bring about success without outside trimmings, but just because they have this great confidence and ability which you have given them. So thank you very much for doing that. Okay, so let me go to the next screen. We are talking about a common home. Until quite recently, the only space we called home was what we could see till the horizon. It was the 1968 Apollo mission that went up and took this picture of Earth from space. The picture is called Earthrise and became very famous because for the first time it showed us a composite planet, not a fragmented one into Park Street or Calcutta, West Bengal, India, but one that showed you the whole, one that showed you how fragile the Earth was, one that showed you how finite our common home was. So this was our common home that was shown. And the astronaut that said there, we set out to explore the moon and instead discovered Earth. Let's zoom down from space to aerial space. And here's a trailer I'm going to show you of a film made by a French documentary filmmaker that has taken photographs of Earth from aerial photographs. See how beautiful this space is. See how we can't see political boundaries of different countries. The only boundaries we do see are geographic ones. And also see, unfortunately, what anthropogenic activities have done to this very beautiful space. That is home. That is a very beautiful home. And unfortunately, mankind thinks that we are masters over nature. COVID has shown us that we are not. We think that technology will help us do anything we want. If it's too hot, we don't have to bother. Just put in another air conditioner. But that's not true. And it is for great people like His Holiness Pope Francis, who proclaimed on Earth Day, he's a great supporter of Earth Day, that we really need to redirect our thoughts. And every religion teaches us about reverence for nature. So let's go back to it. Let's not forget it. I am with Earth Day Network. That is just to briefly show, we began in 1970 on the 22nd of April, and the movement had a lot of students that stood up and demanded that something be done for the pollution levels and other levels. Until then, nobody thought of the smoke billowing out of factories as polluting. They thought it was the fragrance of success because it meant that the men folk could get jobs over there. So today we coordinate with more than 195 countries, 1 billion people commemorate Earth Day. And these are some of our global advisory committee members. Our global theme today is restore our earth. And really, if we love our home, and if we care about ourselves, forget the planet, because the planet will survive if it's a very hot burning one or if it's a cold one. The planet is going to survive. So let's look at reality. We have to do it for ourselves, but because can humans survive in conditions which are so bad? Let's think about that and let's do something for Earth. So Earth Day Network believes greatly in the power of the youth. We believe that Earth's future is dependent on ensuring environmental learning opportunities for youth so that they become wise stewards of the environment. Of course, all of us, adults included, need to be wise stewards, but I'm going to limit my talk today on just what youth can do. And I think that's very important because I, at my age of 70, my lungs may take the pollution of Calcutta, but I want to appeal to the youngsters and tell them, do it for yourself. Can the pollution for 50, 60 years that your lung is going to take, is it not going to affect you? Youth are also very idealistic and they have another ability that all information is there at their, what I call typing fingers. They can get information so easily, much different from my age where we had to sit in a library, borrow a book, and then do that. So Earth Day Network is committed to global environmental literacy, both for women and for youth. And I'm glad to say, although we made this commitment in 2015, we have already reached 3 million youth. So let's look at what's steps to environmental stewardship are necessary. We are fortunate in India that environmental education is compulsory. So that's the first step that has been covered. Second is we have to have conducive conditions to develop environmental literacy. And the third is encouragement to take civic action. So I'm not going to speak so much about education, actual teaching, because St. Xavier's is so great at that. You do it so perfectly. I would just like to mention that we did put together a report for the World Bank, which was then also presented to the then HRD minister on recommendations from 28 roundtables that we held. Some were held in hamlets of Kashmir, others were held in metro cities. The audiences were, or the participants were different. And there were one or two points that might be salient. One is that we teachers have to rethink how do students learn, what appeals to them. So not how we teach, but how they learn. So look at this. This is something that a student might, you know, relate to directly. If you talk to them, but if you tell them that, you know, take out the plug, you'll save so much electricity, it may not. But if you tell them about this, and it actually is called vampire energy, they relate to it. Look at this one. As Siddhant and I were talking a little earlier, his parents were very kind to take my son to school to help, to let him be a backseat buddy with Siddhant when Siddhant went to school. And it was so much better because we didn't run two cars. They shared the car and went. You know, Calcutta police, they tried to get parents to send their children in car shares from the same building and they failed. But we did the opposite. We went to the students and we told them it would be such fun to be a backseat buddy. And we have Ogilvy and Mather who very kindly, you know, made these beautiful posters for us. So that was a success. And the then police commissioner in an open forum said that what they couldn't do, Earth Day Network was able to. So here's something we have just launched. It's called Earth Challenge. It's an app. There are four parts to it. The first is on bees. As Father was mentioning, insects are so very important. And it was only till recently I learned that if the bees die in 4 or 5 years' time, humanity is finished. So this is an app freely available where a student can take a picture of a bee and then put it down there and he or she will get back information and they will be the scientists. So it's so important to involve students, to involve youth, to show them that they can be a part of things. It's not scientists sitting in hallowed laboratories that are only doing the science, but these kids can be the scientists that are taking part in that. NASA, National Geographic, just to name two, are part of this initiative. They will analyze the information and let you know of conditions and of ways to improve them. So how do we appeal to students to make them environment literate? We are taking for granted that St. Xavier's has given a beautiful education. You have taught them all the chemistry and the biology and the physics that is necessary to learn about environmental issues. But that is just knowledge in the head. How are you going to give them an opportunity to come to decisions, to discover for themselves? Here is something we run called Earth Reel. It's a filmmaking competition. And the catch over here is that if the students are told that if you come in the first 10, then 50% of your marks will depend on the research you have done on the subject. So no use showing a beautiful film of the wetlands unless you know what wetlands are. Are they a Ramsar site? How can you restore them? And as a child, what can you do? So this year we went digital with it. And this is a competition now in 8 different languages. The National Council of Science Museums, we work with them on something known as GEMS. We tell schools that just like you appoint monitors, class monitors, you could appoint students to monitor the environment. And these monitors, when chosen, we give them a little bit of training on what makes for a green campus. And then on Earth Day, there's a competition where they come and show you how they have helped improve the campus that they study in. A lot of it is to do with audits that they conduct on electricity use and how they show their management how, you know, they can save money by using different means. So again, to encourage students, we brought together a book of green innovative ideas from students, and we put it together in a volume. I'll be happy to share the link for anybody who's interested. This is all on the net. These are just examples so that others can also emulate them. And now we come to civic action. Very different from my times where all I was told to do was sit and study and not focus on anything else. But today, students are taking civic action. This is from one of our rallies that we had in Mumbai. This is from Chhattisgarh, where they had a cycle rally and did it. And the interesting part was that the chief minister of the state joined the rally itself. This is where we encourage students to, you know, be the heroes, again, relating to something that they are interested in. Not just saying be a superhero, clean up, but showing them how they can relate to the superheroes they know of by being a superhero themselves. Here is a conference that we held in Delhi with the American Center Delhi, where we brought in students from 5 different countries. It was a conference that was held by the students and for the students. Adults had nothing to do there except sit in the wings as experts should any student or any question come up on a technical aspect. Otherwise, they came together, they spoke about the things they did, they built bridges. This is how they built bridges between themselves. And this has carried on because we had 5 countries here. They continue to correspond with each other. They continue to say that this has worked in India, maybe it'll work in Bangladesh, or maybe this will work in other countries. Because if you look at the topography, India's coastline, for instance, is continuous. It's with Pakistan, it is with Bangladesh, and goes down to Myanmar over there. And between Sri Lanka and us, it's just a very small pork strait. It's hardly anything. On the same level, you have Nepal in the north, which is contiguous with our landmass. So what problems will occur in one area can be solved the same way as somebody has found a solution in another space, perhaps. This is a program we launched this year, where we are giving youth a voice, in particular a voice so that they can speak at the upcoming youth conference that is going to be held in Italy, pre-COP, and then the following the COP over there, and the Italian ministry, the Vatican are all supporting this. We have brought together students from 50 countries, all who are leaders, who have a proven track record, and we've given them a common platform so that they can share with each other and learn from each other and join together for our common home. So it's amazing what the students can do. We have, for instance, if I just had to name one, we have Adya Joshi in Bombay, who has put together a whole list of native plants and native trees. And she also approaches the municipalities over there to show them that if you're regrowing, replanting, then you have to use the native varieties and not those from outside. Or we have Aditya Dubey. He's all of 16 years old. He's still in school, but he's the one who filed a petition before the National Green Tribunal. And thanks to his petition, e-commerce platforms like Amazon have now stopped using that double tapes of plastic that they do in wrapping their deliveries. So This is just keeping it to students, but we know that the impact of millions of people who choose to make changes in personal lifestyles cannot be undermined. So we encourage students to take what they know, the privilege of what they have learned, to others. So here we have students who have made these paper bags and then have gone to the shops around their school campus to tell people why paper bags should be used instead of single plastic bags. And they show them how to make these paper bags. And the students say, okay, if you need some, we will make them for you and we will give them to you. We have students who have learned the 9 mantras of saving one unit of electricity per day. And they have taken it back to their parents and told them that, mom and dad, why don't you do this? Why don't you just defrost your fridge regularly? Or why don't you clean the filter in your AC? And this is how much you will save. In all matters here, we have found that if you give them the economic angle, then people are more inclined to doing things which are actually environment friendly. But the environment friendliness comes later. It is what pinches your pocket and what saves you money that comes as the first consideration. This is from KIIT. I don't know if you know that. That's a university in Orissa. A lot of tribal students study there. So when they go home, they were given these mango saplings to take back to their villages. So here the students, they had learned that it's good to plant trees, but they are going to take it back to their communities and help their villages also go green. Coming to Calcutta, this is something where we found that there is a connect with the community. We worked with the Telegraph for this project, which is called Choto Choke Boro Pujo, where the children are the judges of the pandals to see how green they are. So when we first took these children there, the pandal management committee would come running to us and say, please come. And we would say, don't bother about us. You look, your judges are these children, and they were quite taken aback. But these children were amazing. They would say, Dadu, that's very nice, but can I inspect your, you know, generator and to see if it's on silent mode? Or Dadu, this is beautiful. You've drawn a lovely map here, but where is the area where your waste baskets are? Or after you finish the puja in this area, are you going to plant trees? Or with the Anjali flowers that you have, how do you compost them? Or are you only throwing them in the river? So in the beginning, the management committees were a little surprised that they had to answer questions to these little ones. But that's how we worked it out, and it became a fantastic program. So I'm just going to end coming back to the same picture of Earthrise and say this, that we are all in it together. The planet will continue to exist no matter what the conditions, but think about it. Can we? We really need to restore Earth. We really need to do something to build an environment that is conducive to humans living in it. So let's do it for ourselves. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much for a very wonderful and inspirational presentation. I hope all our participants, especially the teachers and the students who are listening, will find lots of ways to incorporate some of these ideas into their daily lives. There was a request, two requests. One was for Father Ignacio Muthu, if we could have a copy of your presentation, Reverend Father. There are some people who are asking for it. And Mrs. Singh, there were a couple of books that you referred to in your presentation. If we could have an Amazon link or a download
link for the links. They're on the Mint. I will just send you the links. You can share them then. Is that okay?
Okay. All right.
I'll just send them to you.
And is there a question, that the question that we have for any of the speakers? I think the The one question I see is something that we've already answered, which is how is global warming affecting our immediate ecological conditions? So I think our speakers have spoken extensively on that. And you know, we are also close to our scheduled time. So can I request the Vice Principal of St. Xavier's Collegiate School, Father Narendra, to please deliver us a formal vote of thanks. Reverend Father Narendra.
After having participated in this inspiring webinar, I'm reminded of that beautiful Native American proverb. When the last tree has been cut down, the last fish caught, the last river poisoned, only then will we realize that one cannot eat money. The reflective words of Pope Francis blend with this very idea as he exhorts, "May the relationship between man and nature not be driven by greed to manipulate and exploit, but may the divine harmony between beings and creation be conserved in the logic of respect and care." Reverend Father Joseph Raphael Hyde, Provincial Calcutta Jesuit Province, Reverend Dr. Thomasin, Principal St. Xavier's Collegiate School and Convener Ecology Commission, Calcutta Jesuit Province, three of our distinguished speakers, Reverend Dr. Ignasi Muthu S.J., Mr. Vijay Vaskar, Ms. Karuna Singh, Mr. Siddhant Paul, Honorary Secretary also, and the members from the also, Reverend Father Jayaraj Beluswamy, Rector, St. Xavier's, Calcutta, Reverend Dr. Dominic Savio, Principal, St. Xavier's, Calcutta, respected fathers and brothers of Calcutta Jesuit Province, religious from different congregations, teachers, students, ladies and gentlemen, good evening to you all. On behalf of the organizing committee, it is my honor and privilege to propose the vote of thanks as we come to the end of this inspiring webinar on care of our common home. First and foremost, I thank the Almighty God, whose bountiful blessings made this program inspiring and a great success. I thank Reverend Father Joseph Raphael Hyde, Provincial Calcutta Jesuit Province, for giving the theme address, introducing the theme of the webinar on care of our common home. His brief address gave all our viewers a comprehensive picture of four universal apostolic preferences of the Society of Jesus, and the importance of respecting and taking care of our common home, God's beautiful creation. Down the centuries, Jesuits across the globe have been contributing a lot, conscientizing people about the care of our common home. Reverend Dr. Ignasi Muthu S.J., one of the distinguished speakers of the webinar, has elaborately spoken of the Jesuit contributions in the field of ecology, such as green drive, solar energy, sanitizer, medicines, fertilizers, books, articles, talks, seminars, retreats, only to mention a few. Father also highlighted the recognitions and acknowledgement given to the Jesuits from the government and national and international levels in this regard. Thank you, Reverend Father, for your informative, reflective, and inspiring sharing. Thank you for making time and consenting to be one of the resource persons for the webinar. Nature has been a powerful and direct source of livelihood for numerous people. Harming nature is disturbing the equilibrium of the ecology and the livelihood of the people who depend on it. I extend my heartfelt gratitude to Mr. Vijay Bhaskar, one of the distinguished speakers of the day, for making us aware of the important role of nature for our survival and the need for refraining ourselves by all means from our exploitative mindset through his provoking sharing on the topic transforming rural lives and livelihoods in harmony with nature. Mr. Vijay Bhaskar highlighted how he has witnessed and has become
part of so many beautiful endeavors that are being done in some of the rural areas, which in a way are at the receiving end. Its sharing on the beautiful initiatives for the welfare of the remotest villages are in fact heartwarming. We are thankful to you, sir, for your kind words and that you have, for the kind of works that you have been doing, and for the poor and the marginalized that you have been working for. What we do to nature not only affects the present but also the future generation. I place on record my heartfelt gratitude to Ms. Karuna Singh, another distinguished speaker of the day, for an inspiring and powerful talk on climate literacy, building bridges to the future generations. As it is rightly said, we inherited a beautiful planet from our ancestors. Now it is our time to leave it in the best shape possible for the generations to come. Ms. Karuna's talk is indeed an invitation to us all to be mindful and not to disturb the ecological balance. The trailer of the film Home that she showed carries a powerful message. Her focus on an invitation to students and their role in doing their parts, preserving and healing the earth, was very inspiring. We pray, dear ma'am, your works in and through your organization bear abundant fruit locally and globally. Thank you for making time amid your busy schedule. No amount of thanksgiving will be sufficient to Reverend Dr. Thomasin Arunappan SJ, Principal St. Xavier's Collegiate School and the convener of Ecology Commission, Calcutta Jesuit Province. His consistent love and care for nature has been clearly visible as he has been going to different Jesuit communities of the province and planting about 1,000 saplings to promote a green and clean environment and taking initiatives in making a herbal garden on the school campus. The culmination of his concern for nature is his effort in organizing today's webinar. He has been planning and coordinating this program for a long time. Thank you, Reverend Father, for your painstaking hard work and for your beautiful welcome address in today's webinar. Mr. Siddhant Kaur, Honorable Secretary Alsop, has been one of the backbones in coordinating, getting in touch with the resource persons, and looking into the nitty-gritty of today's webinar. He has been constantly in touch with Reverend Dr. Thomasin Arunappan and the members of the ALSOC and planning things meticulously for this webinar. Thank you, Mr. Siddhant, for your passion, hard work, and dedication, and above all, for your passionate love for nature. The members of the ALSOC have been a great support during the planning and executing things for today's webinar. I extend my heartfelt gratitude to them all for their selfless and generous commitment. Without the enthusiastic audience and the participants, this webinar would not have been a great success. I thank all the Calcutta Jesuits and all the other participants for your genuine cooperation, wholehearted involvement, and active participation in today's webinar. We are thankful to all those who have worked behind the scene to make this webinar a special and a memorable one. As we disperse, let the words of Pope Francis keep ringing in our hearts and minds. As stewards of God's creation, we are called to make the earth a beautiful garden for the human family. When we destroy our forests, ravage our soil, and pollute our seas, we betray that noble calling. Yes. Each and every one of us can make changes in the way we live our lives and become part of the solution. Let's keep in mind the words of Mohammed Murad: protecting the nature and environment is not only a matter of ethics, but also a matter of existence. Thank you, one and all. May God bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Father Narendra. Thank you to the participants. Thank you to the panelists and the organizers. With this, I would like to close the venue. Thank you once again, Father Tomasin, for being the driving force and inspiration behind this session. We all look forward to putting to action the good thoughts that we have learned tonight. Good night, everyone. Thank you for joining.
Good night. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you.